Dear student, you are welcome in the class of human physiology. Today we will learn about the digestive system. So the digestive system includes the digestive tract and its accessory organ which process food into molecules that can be absorbed and utilized by the cell of the body. So food is broken down bit by bit until the molecule are small enough to be absorbed and the waste product are eliminated. The digestive tract, also called alimentary canal or gastrointestinal tract, consists of a long continuous tube that extend from the mouth to the anus. So it include mouth, pharynx, esophagus, stomach, small intestine and large intestine. The tongue and teeth are the accessory structure located in the mouth. So we'll all cover in this lecture. In this introductory class, we will cover the general aspect of digestion, the basic digestive process, that is motility, secretion, digestion and absorption. We will also learn about the digestive tract and accessory digestive organ. All are briefly described in this lecture. The primary function of the digestive system is to transfer nutrient, water and electrolyte from the food we eat into the body's internal environment. So ingested food is essential as an energy source or fuel from which the cells can generate ATP to carry out their particular energy dependent activities such as active transport, contraction, synthesis and secretion. So food is also a source of building supply for the renewal and addition of body tissue. Normally about 95% of ingested food is made available for the body use. So thus the sequence in nutrition acquisition is ingestion, digestion, absorption, distribution and usage. So there are four basic digestive processes, that is motility, secretion, digestion and absorption. The term motility refers to the muscular contraction that makes and move forward the content of digestive tract. So the smooth muscles in the wall of the digestive tract is basic smooth muscle that display action potential induced burst of contraction and maintain a constant low level of contraction known as tone. Tone is important in maintaining a steady pressure on the content of the digestive tract as well as in preventing its wall from the remaining permanently stressed following the distension. So two basic type of phagic digestive motility are superimposed on this ongoing tonic activity, that is propulsive movement and mixing movement. The propulsive movement propel or push the content forward through the digestive tract, with the rate of propulsion varying depending on the function accomplished by the different regions. Transit of food through the esophagus is rapid, which is appropriate because this structure merely serves as a passageway from the mouth to the stomach. So in comparison, in the small intestine, which is the main site of the digestion and absorption, the contents are moved forward slowly, allowing time for the breakdown and absorption of the food. The mixing movement serves a twofold function. First, by mixing food with the digestive juices, these movements promote digestion of the food. Second, they facilitate absorption by exposing all part of the intestinal content to the absorbing surface of the digestive tract. The contraction of the smooth muscles within the wall of the digestive organ accomplishes movement of the material through most of the digestive tract. So the exception are the end of the tract, the mouth. Through the early part of the esophagus and the external anal sphincter, where the motility involves skeletal muscles rather than smooth muscle activity. So skeletal muscle is under voluntary control, whereas smooth muscle is under involuntary control. The motility can be understood using this figure. So a mixing wave which is initiated in the body of the stomach that progress toward the pyloric sphincter. The more fluid part of the chyme is pushed toward the pyloric sphincter, whereas the more solid center of the chyme squeezes past the peristaltic constriction back toward the body of the stomach. So the peristaltic wave move in the same direction as the mixing wave is propagated, but the peristaltic wave amplitude is stronger than the mixing wave. So again, the more fluid part of the chyme is pushed toward the pyloric region, whereas the more solid center of the chyme squeezes past the peristaltic constriction back toward the body of the stomach. The peristaltic constriction force and few millimeter of the most fluid chyme through the pyloric opening into the duodenum. Most of the chyme, including the more solid portion, is forced back toward the body of the stomach for the further mixing. Another basic digestive process is secretion, and we know that there are several type of secretory cells which is present in the digestive tract that secrete some secretion to help the digestion. Some are exocrine and some are the endocrine type of cells. So a number of digestive juices are secreted into the digestive tract lumen by the exocrine glands. Each digestive secretion consists of the water, electrolyte, and some specific organic constituents that is important in the digestive process, such as enzyme, bile salt, or mucus. So on appropriate neural or hormonal stimulation, the secretion are released into the digestive tract lumen. Normally, the digestion secretion are reabsorbed in the one form or another form into the bloodstream. So after their participation in the digestion, so endocrine cells that is located in the digestive tract wall that secrete gastrointestinal hormone into the blood that help control digestive motility and exocrine gland secretion. Another basic digestive process is the digestion, and human consume three different biochemical category of the energy rich foodstuff: carbohydrate, protein, and fat. So these large molecule cannot cross the plasma membrane intact to be absorbed from the lumen of the digestive tract into the blood or lymph. So the term digestion refers to the biochemical breakdown of the structurally complex foodstuff of the diet into the smaller absorbable unit by the enzyme produced within the digestive system. So most ingested carbohydrate is in the form of polysaccharide, which consists of chain of interconnected glucose molecules. Most common polysaccharide consumed in starch comes from the plant source and glycogen from the animal source. The cellulose, which is present in the plant walls, that cannot be digested by the human species because the human cannot secrete the digestive juices that can digest the cellulose to its monosaccharide form. Hence, the cellulose is represented as the indigestible fiber and bulk of our diets. The disaccharide, which is two sugar molecule including sucrose, also known as table sugar, it has one sugar named glucose and another sugar molecule, that is fructose. The lactose is also called as milk sugar. It also has one molecule glucose and another molecule is galactose. So the process of the digestion, starch, glycogen and disaccharides are converted into their constituent monosaccharides, primarily glucose with small amount of fructose and galactose. So these monosaccharides are the absorbable unit for the carbohydrate polysaccharide molecule. The dietary proteins, which comes from the several animal and plant source, it has a combination of amino acid that held together with the peptide bonds. Through the process of the digestion, the proteins are degraded primarily into their constituent amino acid as well as some polypeptides, which is made up from the amino acid, and both of the peptides and amino acid are the absorbable unit for the protein. The most dietary fat are in the form of triglyceride. The triglyceride are a natural fat molecule. It consists of a glycerol molecule attached with the three fatty acid molecule. During the digestion, two of the fatty acid molecule are split off and leaving the monoglyceride as glycerol molecule with one fatty acid molecule attached. So the end product of the fat digestion are monoglyceride and free fatty acid molecule, which are the absorbable unit for the fat. Digestion is accomplished by the enzymatic hydrolysis, means breakdown by the water molecule. So by adding water at the bond site, enzyme in the digestive secretions break down the bonds that hold the small molecule subunit within the nutrient molecule together, thus setting the small molecule free. The removal of water at the bond site originally joined these small subunit to form the nutrient molecule. Hydrolysis replaced the water molecule and free the small absorbable unit. Digestive enzymes are very specific in the bond they can hydrolyze. So as food moves through the digestive tract, it is subjected to the various enzymes, each of which break down the food molecule even further. In this way, the large food molecule are converted to split the absorbable unit in a progressive step-wise fashion, like an assembly line in reverse. So as the digestive tract content are propelled the forward direction. So here is the example of hydrolysis. The disaccharide maltose sugar molecule, which is an intermediate of the breakdown product of the polysaccharide molecule, is broken down into two glucose molecule by the addition of water molecule at the bond site. Next digestive process is the absorption. So in the small intestine, digestion is completed and most absorption process will take place in the small intestine. And absorption is very important phenomena for the digestion and for the energy generation and for the metabolic activity. So through the process of the absorption, the large absorbable unit that result from the digestion along with the water, vitamins and electrolytes are transferred from the digestive tract lumen into the blood or lymph. Now we will briefly learn about the digestive tract and their accessory digestive organs. So the digestive system that consists of the digestive tract or gastrointestinal tract, gastro means stomach, and it is also called the alimentary canal, plus the accessory digestive organs that constitute pancreas and gallbladder as well as the salivary glands. So the accessory digestive organs that include the salivary gland, exocrine pancreas, and the biliary system, which is composed of the liver and the gallbladder, and these exocrine organs lie outside of the digestive tract and empty their secretions through duct into the digestive tract lumen. So the digestive tract is essentially a tube about 4.5 meter or approximately 15 feet in length in its normal contractile state. So running through the middle of the body, the digestive tract include the following organ like mouth that consists palate, tubula, tongue, teeth, the pharynx, the esophagus, the stomach, the small intestine that has three parts, duodenum, jejunum, ileum, and the large intestine that has colon, cecum, and rectum, as well as the anus. So these organs are continuous with one another and they are considered as a separate entities because their regional modification, which allow them to specialize in particular digestive activities. Because the digestive tract is a continuous from the mouth to the anus, the lumen of this tube is continuous with the external environment. Actually, the content within the lumen of the gastrointestinal tract are technically outside of the body. So only after a substance has been absorbed from the lumen across the digestive tract, it is considered a part of the body. So this is important because the conditions which is essential to the digestive process can be tolerated in the digestive tract lumen that could be not tolerated in the proper human body. Now we can see the example of the digestive process that can be tolerated in the digestive tract but could not be tolerated in the body. First one is pH of the stomach that fall as low as 2 as a result of the gastric secretion of the HCl. So, yet in the body fluid, the range of the pH compatible with the life is 6.8 to 8, which is alkaline, and the pH 2 is very highly acidic. So, the digestive enzyme that hydrolyzes the protein in food that could also destroy the body on tissue that reduce them. The protein is the main structural component of the cell. So therefore, when these enzymes are synthesized in inactive form, so they are not activated until they reach to the lumen. So where they actually attack the food outside of the body. So thus is within the lumen, and thereby the protecting the body tissue against self-degradation. The another digestive process that is tolerated in only in the digestive system is the presence of gut microbiota. Actually, the lower part of the intestine have quadrillions of the living microorganisms that are normally harmless and even beneficial. But if these microorganisms enter into the body system, for example, during the rupture of the appendix, so they may be extremely harmful or even lethal. The foodstuffs are the complex foreign particles that would be attacked by the immune system if they were in contact with the body. However, the foodstuffs are digested within the lumen into absorbable units such as glucose, amino acid, and fatty acid that are indistinguishable from these simple energy-rich molecules already present in the body. So in this class, we have learned about the digestive system, its overview, their definition, organs of the digestive system, the accessory glands and exocrine, endocrine glands present in the digestive system, the accessory organs like salivary gland, biliary system, liver, and the basic digestive process, that is motility, secretion, digestion, and the absorption. The phagic digestive motility, we have analyzed the propulsive movement and the mixing movement which is necessary for the digestion process. So this is the question answer session, and I am giving you some question for the homework. So you just search the internet and answer these questions. First question is to discuss the type of phagic digestive motility. The you should elaborate the sequence in nutrient acquisition. You should explain the basic digestive process. I have give you idea about the digestive secretion. So you just explore the digestive secretion and discuss the type of the secretory cell present in GI tract. And another question is, you have to outline the accessory digestive organs. So these are the references for learning the human physiology. You can learn with the Sherwood. Guyton and Hall is another textbook of the medical physiology. The Human Physiology and Integrated Approach is another very good book. The Principle of Human Physiology, Principle of Human Physiology, written by the Carpenter, is also a very informative book. So you can go with the any of these books. I will recommend you to learn from the Sherwood and Guyton.